And I feel like I make with two different hearts. On one hand, I grew up in this rugged beauty that we are all, that you guys are more familiar with. Usually when I give this talk, I have to talk a little bit about the coast of Maine and how the natural environment is so important to, I think, your psychological state when you live here. And growing up within that, I think it made me see the way things grow, the way they melt, the sort of truth that there is in things like the freeze and thaw and erosion. And that's continually a part of my design vocabulary. So the kind of compositions I'm putting together, I'm thinking about all of these, and moving a small, I'm not really pointing at those mountains. Those are the Appalachians, actually. I've lived there for a little bit. But I think about these forces of nature and what they have to say when I'm building work. And a lot of people ask, artists tend to have little knickknacks and collections and stuff. And I don't actually keep a physical collection, but this is my collection, that I collect these images of forces of nature and the kind of vocabulary, this kind of vocabulary of truth that I see within them. On the other hand, I'm also a part of this super fast media culture flying down the road, images flying into my mind of power, beauty, money, all these things that are happening constantly. And it's a part of my psychology. Corporate logos, they get in your mind and they affect you one way or another. What I do with these two different hearts is I abstract these one would think of as disparate influences into designs that tend to have all this messy stuff conflated in. And I like to be said about, I like to make things complicated. They're like, okay, if I can really explain it, then I just failed. but we'll try a little bit. So I think of these forces of nature and also forces of culture. So you could say a force of culture is a green versus a red button, right? It's a force of culture, something we agreed upon. So here's some points. This is a little bit light, so some of the drawings are falling away. But so I draw and I take these different influences. And of course, one of the giant influences is furniture. And I say that I design furniture, but for the most part, I'm creating these situations, and it's really all seating. Seating, for the most part. Yeah, so it's all, what I think of is one of the more, different types of furniture have different roles in our life. The role of a chair or a bench is a very intimate role. It's also a kind of script for experiments. So, sneaky art, or sneaky, isn't that right? Sneaky art.
Sneaking
the art in. I like that. By choosing a format that has a historical precedent, right? I'm choosing a play, you know, it's like being able to have a stage set for the experience, and then, well, what's going to happen when you go into that experience? That's a chair, by the way. So this is version one, it's called Current. There's a white one in the back there, watching the lecture along with you. I think of, so not only am I, one of the reasons I love furniture is this sneaky art. One of the reasons I love chairs is the intimate interaction. So the physical interaction, the mental interaction is all mixed up. But I also love, on the other hand, that chairs also have always been a stand-in as a character. So they're also a caricature of us, that they're used often as a symbol for, you know, a small chair in the corner with a little light above it would be a lonely person, right? So that we inherently have a certain narrative with empty chairs, especially. So And that's really a part of furniture design, specifically chairs within furniture design, is that the fancy word would be the anthropomorphic nature of furniture. But it would mostly just mean that it's like us. It has feet, it has arms, it has a back, right? It has all those things. And furniture has always been described this way. Some of the earliest chairs within sort of what I see as our lineage, of the kind of Greco-Roman lineage of furniture, is the Greek Kronos, which had these big lions being on it. There's certain leg forms that are still in a lot of the furniture we see today, but that they were based on animals. Mine are based on a sort of interaction not only with this forces of nature, forces of culture, but also with industry. And you know, we're talking a little bit about metal earlier, we're going to talk a whole bunch more about metal. Most of my work is metal, pretty much all of my work is metal, except for the new stuff, which is kind of exciting. This is the Ruffle series, we have a few over there. So I work with industrial materials, and they have a certain associations to them of, you know, strength, rough, sparks flying, very masculine. And of course, that's not really complicated enough. So I like to make them flippy and feminine. And I look a great deal, one of the forces of culture I look at quite a bit is, of course, fashion. It hit me one day that really muscle cars and lipstick have a lot in common, right? So there's this kind of combination of, you know, physical sort of satisfaction of having this really visceral experience of you're flying down the road and say this big rumbling muscle car, the vibrations, the music's blasting, the wind's in your hair. Part of it's about the performance of the vehicle, right? You know, it's like flying down the road. And part of it is just, wow, I must look awesome right now, right? So you have that physical experience of the object being awesome, to use a very technical term, but also that you feel like you're more attractive or more amazing because you're entering into and interacting with this really amazing object. And I think lipstick's very the same. You know, it feels good to put it on and you feel wonderful when you have it on, right? This is some of the sculpture. This is very similar to the one in the front yard, Russell. And a lot of it, I'm thinking all of these ideas about the physical interaction, the lusciousness, and sort of these are thrones up in the air, even though you're not getting to physically interact with them, my hope is that you could have some kind of imaginative relationship to being up, floating around in this cloud. When I was making this series of work, which I called the Sight of Sound series specifically, I was thinking of, I think I was living up in the mountains of Carolina, I was missing the ocean, I was thinking of that sound on aluminum rigging is down at the coast, and that's really, so sometimes my work will start from a very literal abstraction, line drawing based on something I've looked at, and sometimes it is just a feeling, that the nostalgia of that specific sound is a feeling that I was trying to capture, how I felt when I heard it. You've seen this one, How Practice is Sensation. This is some installation shots of a project I did down in Portland. So if you happen to be driving through Portland, go down to the Back Bay, right near the entrance. Yeah, there's a little park, Portland's little park. And this was really fantastic because, experience for me, because I got a chance to work with a bunch of people to do a much larger project, and having the experience of working with a number of people and thinking about the place more than just the object. Of course, I'm very much an object maker. It's about the power of the object, but being able to, or having the assignment to think about the space and how people were going to interact with it, what it was going to do for the community, you know, how it was going to survive over time, all of those different things, and how the object acted within that space, of course, was really wonderful. This kind of goes back to that idea of the anthropomorphic for me, that there's a few different things that furniture does, right? One, it's a place to hang out, to sit, to use, it fulfills a function. This is a good slide to talk about this. This is a bench that I took a picture of out in Two Lights State Park, one of my favorite places in Portland. When I was there, I did my undergrad at Maine College of Art, so I lived in Portland for 4 years. I took a bunch of pictures of chairs, who knew? but there was something, I loved this picture because seeing it empty, I thought of that, well, okay, it almost becomes narrative instantly, just because it's empty. If there was one person in that chair, it also became a narrative, but a different one than the empty chair. If there were two people, again, a different narrative. So this idea of sight and of furniture being functional, that furniture is a sight all on its own. It is sight specific to the body, sight specific to certain interactions, depending on what kind of furniture it is, right? So folding chairs, a certain kind of narrative, right? A bench, like the one that's outside that I have here, is another kind of narrative. It's built maybe for three people, probably for two, and you kind of fall into each other a little bit because of the angle. A different story. I'll talk more about material in a little bit, but this is Red Rocker. It's built just like a hot rod would be, all English wheel, hand hammered, it's all steel. With auto body finishes, most of this work does have auto body finish on it. So it's like acrylic lacquers. And I worked with steel for a long time before I came around to color, and it was blew my mind because it gave me the ability to do what I was talking about, was playing with that masculine, feminine, industrial, you know, glamorous kind of line in a different way. And in color, it can soften so much. If all of this work was just plain, and I apologize, the color's a little off on this. I love too the names of these colors are amazing. This is a BMW color called the Phantom Gray Pearl. again, color is amazing. It has a lot of reference for us. And the colors that I'm using are pulling already from the cultural reference because I am choosing, for the most part, sometimes I mess around with it and make my own color. For the most part, I'm choosing a color from a particular car, from a particular brand, from a particular year. So, for instance, you don't find a whole lot of orange these days, unless it's a Kawasaki or like a little bike or something. But in the 80s, the cars were orange, right? So tastes change, and that you can access a certain feel again, so a certain time via the color. These are called the Anchored Candy series. This is definitely entering into the muscle car and stick land.
So you're going to be anchored what?
Candy.
Anchored candy.
Mm-hmm. And they're all steel. The blocks are just patinaed steel, so they're just, for instance, that makes it easier, right? and this one's called the Ruby Red Slipper. This was one of my favorite paints I think I've ever applied. And anybody in a auto, in a cars with paint in the group? No?
I've used them.
There's so many layers of paint on this, and it makes it glow, right? So not only is there a base color that's is like a creamy pink pearlescent On top of that, there's a urethane, so it has just a little bit of this candy color in it, and then crushed glass floating inside of that. So when you see it in person, and when the lights come back up, you can take a close look at this one too, that there's actually particulates of shine floating in there. So the kind of the richness of color flared up has a lot to do with particulates.
It's more akin to a manicure.
There you go, it is. Or a pedicure, depending on how you feel. This is some of the concrete work, which I know parents that are very wanted to hear some about. This one's from a new series. It's called Between the Devil and DBC. It's pure pigments, concrete, ferro cement technique, hand stainless steel. And this one's in the back of the truck, actually. This is the pictures with the projector's really rough. It's a pure pigment again, so it's a titanium dioxide actually just inside the Portland cement. And they are hollow formed. I'll show you a few pictures of how they're built. And then rusted steel. All of the lines that you see are the armature itself. And then, of course, the bridge bench that's outside, where you can sit with your friend and lean towards each other. I'll talk a little bit about history and material, all the wonders of metal. I'm a metalworking. And very much I empathize with the working of the material, the air hammer, and how once you know how to use it, it just moves. It's like liquid, right? Okay, it isn't, but it feels like it is, once you know what it does. I worked as a blacksmith for a couple of years. This is a sample piece from one of the projects I did. And although I don't use any blacksmithing techniques anymore, the time in which I did that job really changed the way I was thinking metal and that squishiness of the material, thinking of it as clay in many ways. So it's forever inside my vocabulary of form. So here's some bits and pieces. Here's some betrayal of that time. And I also feel like working as a blacksmith made me really unintimidated to experiment. I just thought, hey, it's just metal. It's soft. It can do anything. These are actually pieces from Current. Our piece is very much like Current. So they're just bent hot, a little jig, throw it together, no big deal. But one of the things, and I'll talk about a subtlety that you can see in Current itself, is that by doing that forming hot versus cold or versus having it cut out, there's this subtle bend and flex in the form that has to do with this very natural curving. And it's written in the material because it was done hot. And it supports the fiction that I'm trying to set up, say, in that piece, that this was all one flat sheet that somebody just went squished one day and it happened to fall into that form. I use, again, I don't use very much heat now. I use slip roller and the wheel. I can't hammer those slip rolls. These are patterns for another exciting sound series. These are actually images from when I was building the Portland piece. And I use, on the thicker material, this is 1/8 inch stainless steel. I use a hydraulic press with different forms. Those are some different forms. And it's a great way to move thicker material to thinner material. That's a bench that you saw earlier with phantom gray pearl on it. So imagine there wasn't the paint on these pieces, right? Completely different characters. They work really in congruous. And this is an image from the back porch. Those were all in the workspace when I lived in North Carolina. And I lived in North Carolina for about 4 years, 3 years of that. I was in a residency there at the Penland School of Craft, and I've been very lucky to be able to do some, live in a number of places and do a number of residencies, that one being definitely the longest, being 3 years long. here and there, and that was one of the really big ones for me. I finished another residency that was just a semester long, maybe 3 months ago, at Purchase College, just north of New York City. And this is Purchase. There's a lot of brick there. I mean, a lot of brick. This constant, endless pattern of brick. And walking through this area of just endless, endless repetitive pattern, and this definition of form, very different form than I work in, of this white line and then this sea of red, or then, you know, they were also doing construction and there was a lot of this around too. So my life was filled with all of this linear pattern. So I eventually said, okay, I think I need to respond to this. All of this rectilinear pattern is driving me crazy. I think I need to make something curvy. So I started taking the models, and I've used these, what I call wire models, but it's really 3/8 rod stock that's been formed and welded together, as what you would call buck, which is just a form for doing sheet metal work. But I decided, these are some shots of some of the aluminum work I've been doing. English wheel in action. But I started, you know, I was getting this, I was living in this land of linear pattern, and I was getting a lot of responses because I was working really in the public at the school there about these forms that I was making to just get my sheet metal worked out, and then I'd throw them away, right? And I decided, well, okay, I'm not going to throw it away. I'm going to make some work with it. Well, I'm going to flip it upside down and put concrete into it and then reveal the structure. It's been really fun to experiment with it. Ferrous cement is very versatile. It's used for architecture. It's been used for boat building. You basically do a cement mixture with sand and some other additives these days. There's so many additives, right? Great technology. And you squish it in a wire mesh with an armature. Mm-hmm. That's great. Of course, what I'm trying to do with what I've been doing in this work is revealing that armature. So in some ways, the internal structure is actually the external decoration all at the same time.
Cool.
Which I like that. I like it when things get turned inside out. It's lots of grinding, though, as you can see. And this is my 1 week view into one of my favorite parts of my studio in New Hampshire, because there's lots of wind to blow the dust away. There's a larger piece in there. There's a lot of that in this new body of work, grinding the concrete, to reach down in and find that armature. That's one kind of halfway done. And that's what my hands look like every single day. There's something, I do most of the work myself as well. And I think there's something very important about having that biofeedback from the material, that it very much informs my process. It's very much a practice. The art for me is very much a practice. And that is a strong counterbalance to being a designer. So I'm making, and that's important, but the making is feeding into the design work, hopefully making it complicated. That's it for me. If you guys have questions, how do you want to work the questions? I do have a video I can just throw up that'll be entertaining while people ask questions if you want.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah, you're working.